Research and and the kind of realization projects in China, which are very, very interesting, and also targeting those very, very privileged people. So without further ado, I just pass the stage to Mark, and also thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks, TC. I think you've pretty much covered everything, so we can go over now. And thanks to Patrick as well for inviting us to speak today. Basically, the talk today, we're going to focus mostly, I'll give some a bit of background about how we set up the office and kind of some of our interests. And then Maggie will talk specifically about two projects, one which is the self-divided tuning project that TC mentioned, and the second one on social housing. That's what we plan to talk about today. We also have, if you're interested, we also can talk about perhaps one of our projects that we've done in mainland China. See how much time we have. Basically, we're going to talk. If you have any questions as we're going through, feel free to shout out. We're happy to interact as we go through. So I'll start. So the title, maybe I can first talk about the title of the talk. So originally we were thinking of the title of What is Good Architecture is a common question we asked. But then we thought, this question asked maybe about what is good design, or what is architecture about, something that performs well or looks nice. But then we thought, what if we reverse the question and instead ask what good is architecture? And think more about the moral question involved in this. And also question the social responsibility that we have as architects. And kind of through this question, we can question the act of architecture itself. So a couple of things that we'll probably talk about today. One is, I think we're interested in the kind of human aspect, as TC mentioned, humanism within architecture. Also, we're interested in professionalism and how these two quite different things can interact with each other. I wasn't sure how to start the talk, and then yesterday, or the day before, we were out walking through Changsha Wan, and there was a show flat for this new development in Hong Kong. And I was quite interested in this this floor plan. On one hand, it's, on one hand, it's dealing with the issue of professionalism. So the architect is quite a well-known architect within Hong Kong. And the architect obviously has to realize the GFA requirements of the client and produce a very well-detailed, professionally planned drawing. But then on the other hand, I was kind of interested in looking into this house, and we can argue about the AC platform and why is there a utility platform in the master bedroom, which seems a little bit strange. We can argue about the latest development of using a curtain wall within a residential development. We can argue about all of these things, but the thing that really interested me was the utility room, which is next to the entrance. And this is a space this is my interpretation of the drawing. I don't know the building, I don't exactly know the facts. But the utility room, according to this drawing, is a room without any windows. And yet, at the same time, the dimension of this room is exactly, approximately 2 meters by 1 meter, or 1.5 meters. It's just the right size for a bed to fit in, basically. And I think we can imagine, what this room is going to be used for within this kind of house. It's probably a high chance that it will be the domestic helper's room. So the architect has drawn this. It could be that you could argue it's the client's requirement to have this room, or it's the condition of, this is what's expected in the house. But why has the architect in this situation created a room without any windows? Which is going to be a habitable space. So I think this is it's kind of raises interesting questions. So that's kind of the start. So then, maybe I sort of rewind a little bit and talk a bit about our background and how we got to being here. So, as mentioned, Maggie obviously studied here. I studied in the UK in the University of Sheffield under Professor Jeremy Till. I think we were encouraged to explore a wide range of different architectural, different ways that we can practice architecture, basically, different modes of practice, encouraged to read quite widely around the subject. But also covering, kind of looking at social issues, but also design issues. So not ignoring one or the other. On the other hand, Maggie's education in CU was very focused at that time, and still is, I think, very focused on habitational elements. So this is a primal condition of architecture. So this is the mother creating a shelter for her child. So it's kind of looking at the very basic, fundamental aspects of architecture. How we inhabit space, how we create space. That's a very brief introduction to our background. After graduating, then our experience is very common to most architectural graduates. We went to work in different scale of offices, commercial offices, large and small, working on sort of residential projects, commercial projects. You know, it's a very typical experience. And I think we just felt kind of quite detached from what we'd learn. It's kind of, on one hand at school we learned about habitation and the social aspects of architecture, but what we were practicing was very different. And I think for all of you this is maybe something you will also encounter. Doing this kind of project. Also at the same time, I think we used to put this slide in, so this is talking about the PNAP and kind of the building control within. I think we used to be quite critical of this, but I think now we've matured a little bit, and for me as well, I'm recently going through my professional examination, and I can kind of more understand the professional nature or appreciate the professional nature of architecture and why it's important to be professional. Unless we believe in like total anarchy or something, then you know it's important that we have these building codes. We have to analyze which are the useful codes to help people and which ones are, you know, which ones are not there to help us have this space. So I think we need to look more critically at these kind of situations. Then a few years after working, first Maggie and then I, we both had this experience or this chance to work in Rural Urban Framework, which is based in the University of Hong Kong. You may be familiar with their work. So this is more, this work is more, is closely, more closely related to what we're interested in. So for us, it was kind of a really good experience. So this is working in, primarily they're working in rural projects in mainland China, kind of developmental projects. I think the thing that interested us was, so this is a model which is similar to, say, the work of Rural Studio and Samuel Mockby. It's kind of how these situations which can exist in the academic world, maybe has support from the academic kind of institution. But for Maggie and I, we were interested in how could we pursue this, like as a, you know, set up an office to do this as a profession, really as a practice. So that's kind of how Donut was formed. So this is what TC was mentioning. So this is our sale. Quickly go through this. This is our sales pitch. So basically, we're on the far right hand side. You have a commercial practice. On the left hand side, you have a charity. We're kind of somewhere in the middle, but a little bit closer towards the charitable side. I won't explain. And then, as TC was mentioning, we're our mission basically is interested in how we can serve the less privileged people in society and expand the service of architects. And at the same time, we're not saying that this is what all architects should do. We still believe, you know, what we're doing is one, like a small branch within architecture, but there's all these other kinds of architecture that also exist. So we started off working, our first few projects we were working also in rural China in this kind of setting. But in the past few years we've actually shifted our focus more to Hong Kong. now we have quite a few projects based in Hong Kong. So that's really what we're going to focus on today. So I guess it's widely reported recently, or several years, that Hong Kong is like the most, one of the most unaffordable places to live in the world. And even in Hong Kong, there's one, like a third of the population are living in subsidized housing, or one fifth of you can't have affordable forms of housing. But we're interested in those families or those people who cannot, they're not eligible for public housing, or they're on the waiting list for public housing. So, and then I guess, so this, these are the statistics. So I mean, still the proportion is probably the same. That one in five of the population are living below the poverty line. And on the project, the home modification project in the subdivided units, this affects us because we're working with children, with families with children. So it means there's roughly, I guess it says 200,000 children that are living within, like, within poverty. So these are the background facts. And then as architects, this affects us through the creation of subdivided houses. I guess subdivided houses are interesting because they kind of exist because of the laissez-faire market within Hong Kong. So there's this demand for affordable housing, and dividing the houses up into smaller and smaller units, then the landlords can create this, this answer to the demand. And I think the interesting thing about this situation is it's kind of this friend, we're discussing with a friend, and it's hard to imagine that because the subdivided units exist within these kind of old tenement buildings, but from the outside we can't actually appreciate the condition inside the building. So it's kind of the situation that the families are facing is this kind of invisible situation. So I wonder if it's partly because of this, because you can't see it from this. If you look at pictures of slums in India or other parts of the world, and you can see this condition, and you can see that, you can imagine the situation looks quite bad. But in Hong Kong, because this all happens behind closed doors, so I wonder why this is this partly why the issue is not more widely kind of reported. This is a house that we visited before. This is like probably the most extreme house that we've visited to date. This is a family of four living in here. It's roughly 150 square. It's a typical subdivided unit, around 150 square feet, so around 15 square meters. But you can see the way that the building's been chopped up, and just it's really bizarre. It's like a long corridor, basically. It's just a really thin space, so it's just enough space to fit in a bed, space for the toilet. So it's quite a strange case as well. And then this is a recent study that we were doing. We visited the house, and we always look at, because we always visit the subdivided unit itself, but we never kind of appreciate how it's come into existence. So for this, we actually, we went to the, you can download the building plans from DD. So we kind of analyzed this house. So this is the original house as it was built in the 1950s.
That's a long hour.
This is a long hour, yeah. So quite, quite typical with the central staircase and then the house on either side, with balconies. And obviously, balconies tend to be built in. So the next slide, this is the house that we visited, actually on the right-hand side. So what we've done is, so if you compare to before and after. So the left-hand house we didn't visit, but we kind of used our imagination of how the family would have. Probably, we imagine they were filled in the balcony to create some bedrooms or extra space. That's quite helpful. But then we compare it to the house. So this is maybe a house for, this would be a normal family house, two or three, four people would comfortably live in here. This is around 600 square feet, 600 or 700 square feet, this house. And the house on the right is the actual house that we visited. So this one, the landlord has actually divided the house into eight units. So each one is around 60 square feet or less. it's kind of unbelievable, really, how you can compare like one family. So for this case, we actually visited Unit 2. There's a family of three people living in here. So on one hand, you have like, on the left-hand side, this is a normal house for a family of three, and then on the right-hand side, this is for the low-income families. And each house is maybe, you know, we didn't visit all of the houses, but there could maybe easily be two people living, two or three people living in each house. So it's just, it's kind of mind-boggling how this situation can evolve. We can maybe talk more about this later, why this kind of situation exists. I mean, we have different ideas. As Sebastian mentioned, the houses are often in the top now, so in these old buildings, and these are usually buildings which are awaiting redevelopment. So you can imagine, perhaps the landlord, they purchased their house, and as a long-term investment, they hope that one day the area can be redeveloped, and, you know, they get a good return on their investment. Perhaps because the house is nearing the end of its life, so they think they can divide the house into smaller units and they can gain some extra income while they wait for redevelopment. But then, is it the landlord being greedy that they've created this situation? Is it just because there's demand in the market that, you know, are they neutral in this position? Can you argue that actually they divided the house just expecting one person to live in there? You know, perhaps one person can quite comfortably live in there, but the landlord didn't anticipate two or three people living in there. So I think these are interesting questions that they raise. So then this is the kind of, how many of you have you all visited the subdivided units now? Has anyone visited? Okay, so this is one of the houses we visited. I wouldn't say it's a typical, it's more extreme, it's quite messy. So this is a family of her father and her parents and her daughter living here. And the father, in his spare time, he would collect electrical appliances from the street and then take them apart and then repair them and then sell them for money for an extra income. This is another family we visited, and this is just a small part of the house. And on one hand, this looks very chaotic and untidy, but actually, when you analyze the picture, this is because the family is, this is a four-person family, and actually they're quite organized in the way they live. They've kind of utilized the high ceiling space, and they've tried to organize the, you know, as best as they can, because they're living in such a cramped condition. They try to organize what they can. So, I think that's kind of the introduction, so pass over to Maggie now. She'll talk more details of the project.
So the project we are about to talk about is a home occupation project. It's exactly the situation that Mark talks about in context, and the charity approaches trying to find a solution for it. So we started this project since 2013. And at the beginning, when we face such a chaotic space, we try to analyze what kind of stuff the family have. And we found that although it looks like a lot of stuff in the house, but all are essential elements. So they are cooking materials, there are study materials, and clothing, and all are essential items because they are living in such a cramped space. And at the same time, they tend to accumulate a lot of stuff, also because of their low income situation, because they have a kind of insecurity feeling that if they throw away something today, they may not be able to buy it tomorrow. So they tend to keep a little bit more stuff than normal people. Maybe they saw some cheap toilet roll, they would buy three packs at one time. So this is kind of a situation that they face. So we also look at a lot of different subdivided houses, trying to figure out how we could help. And looking at these situations, I think it is quite easy to suggest to, as a designer, as an architect, it's very easy for us to suggest an interior renovation or making a space good, trying to hide everything, trying to give them all the shelf that can fit into the walls. But at the same time, we also trying to understand the context because they are all rented. So we kind of look at the space and also realize that some spaces actually the walls are quite blank. As you can see in some of the photos, it is because actually the furniture they got for the house, either they are given by other people or they just collect from rubbish dump, and it's actually not very suitable for the house and not stacked. So a lot of the high ceiling spaces which the tenement house actually provided is wasted. So when we analyze the condition, as you can see on the higher ceiling level, actually most of the time it's empty. So for us, we started to design the project based on this potential of the high ceiling space. So the reason why we don't renovate the house is also extension of our understanding of the context that Mark has mentioned before. Why there's a divided unit appeared is kind of one of the factors, because the landlord actually can gain more rent from dividing the area to smaller area, and all add together they actually earn a higher rent. So in this case, if we renovate the house, we will give them a better architectural interior condition, it's very likely the landlord can take advantage of this and raise the rent. So in this project, we decided to use furniture as a spatial modifier, as a tool to help the family to organize their space so that the family can carry the furniture with them to the future. So you can kind of think in the sort of context what happened to the user at the end as well, because they will probably, after 1 or 2 years, they have to move to another subdivided unit, and eventually they're moving to public housing. So for the queue for public housing, is about 5 to 7 years now. So by the time they move to public housing, actually their children would have been passed through the primary school level already. So in this project, we also especially look into the education issues. We hope to provide a good study space in the house, or at least each child to have their own study desk, so that they can have a better study environment at home, and hopefully they can escape from the poverty cycle and they can study better. So with the scale of the project that we work on, actually the aim of the project now is to expand to 300 families. So the furniture units that we designed is also trying to make it modular so that it's easier to produce, and also because of the changing space condition afterwards, because we don't know what kind of space they will move to outdoors, so that they can reorganize the furniture, they can use the modular system, they can mix and match in their new home, so that they can reuse the tool in a different way. Just a very simple spatial concept that we try to utilize the high ceiling level and push the storage space to the top and try to free up the middle area so that the furniture is not blocking away, give them more space in the middle. There are different types of furniture, so because the scheme is especially for children, so they are trying to provide children-friendly furniture and study desk, and also storage space, and because not all the subdivided homes are the same, so we also have some flexible units to fill up the gaps. So for the materials, because we have a long-term consideration for the project, then they need to be able to move to the other house until they go to the public housing. Actually, we are just using very simple material, but durable material. So this is just a simple plywood, but it's the cost is almost equivalent to very cheap mass-produced furniture, but we reduce the cost by just taking off all the decoration and just use clear varnish to make it very simple. And if the furniture is broken, they can people can see it and can just easily repair it. So we also not trying to get rid of all the furniture in the house. We try to reorganize with the existing furniture so that the existing furniture work with our new furniture as well. So and other aspects is we can try to understand the space with different time of the day. And I realized that actually sonic is very important for the memory. So that's when the mother is cooking, they are not walking across the child to study space to get to the food in the fridge. So we are trying to reorganize the sonic in the house so that they have a better dedicated area for study and also easier area to work on other than daily habits. So these are the just a sequence of the projects. And I think it's each individual cases are a mediation architectural project. You go to site research and try to do a design and presentation with the family, and then you install the furniture and try to check the quality of. So these are some of the finished cases. I think we are not aiming at showing a very trendy, very luxury style. We are looking at more the furniture, be able to blend in with the family, but in a subtle way, we also introduce some alignment in the furniture, trying to organize, give them a more organized space. So up to now, we have worked with 90 families, and I think more than 90 families. Actually, it's interesting to witness the daily routine and understand more about habitation while we're visiting them. So I think that as a designer and architect, I think we can actually learn more about the daily routine from working with this harsh situation. So these are some of the study table that we provided. We have this secret drawer, which is actually from my childhood experience, that I like to make some drawings under my book when I study. So I like to have this secret drawer that my mom doesn't know that I have a drawing underneath my desk. So this become a quite interesting space because some of the family after implementing the child actually very care very much about these studies and don't let the parents to open the drawers. So I think in this way it's actually helped to generate an organization skill for them to look after the house and try to organize their own space as well and take ownership of their study area. So the second project is just maybe I'll just talk very briefly, is about social housing, which is also kind of related. And when the family, I don't know how many of you have heard about social housing. I think it's not this year or last year. It's basically the charities or the government supporting the charities trying to run this housing with vacant units, vacant space, which can allow more underprivileged family to live in as an additional temporary measure for housing, for the lack of proper housing. So first, when we approached this project, we kind of asked what is social housing? And a lot of the time, it's mixed up with the idea of co-living. But it's also the way how is it implemented now. But Lesotho housing, the difficulty is that when you make two families, which are two or three families, which are underprivileged, collect together, it's actually much harder than just young people living together, because they also have their social issues on their social, their habits on being being a low income family, and they are scared of, they have a high level of insecurity. So in social housing, I think it's important to think about what we could provide, and people should be able to have control or ownership of the space that they live in. So the project we work on are also in this tenement house in Tongao, and it is a relatively bigger unit, but only 72. In a way, we also question ourselves: are we providing something about the unit for the people, just a better subdivided unit, and how is it going to be different from the subdivided unit that we deal with before? So at the beginning, we also try to partition the unit in a different way, try to make some model and try to generate some idea. But from making model is not just about the shape. At the same time, we kind of after making all these different shape and approach, we kind of reach to add other more conceptual ideas, which is how to partition the house. So the traditional way to partition the units would be two individual private units, separated and just introduce a corridor. And so after this exploration exercise, we realized that actually we can produce some shared space, and also can produce a space that be able to give family options that they can change. So because then when the two families are low income, it's very hard to say that they can get along together very well. So we want to be able to cater for different conditions when they cannot get along, when they can get along, so that they can make a choice after the movement. So we introduced this partition system. If you look at the middle space here, so this is actually the same flat. We introduced the removal partition so that if the two families move in after, when they move in, it's very common for them to stay very secure, and because they don't actually know each other. So we want them to still live happily and have their own private space. So this kind of partition that they can choose to open or close. So if the two families really working together, they can actually enjoy a bigger private space. And another thing is we try to provide double sets of toilet, because from our understanding, actually toilet is a very private space. So if the family doesn't take ownership of the toilet, if there's a shared toilet, actually no one is going to clean up someone else's toilet. So we want to make sure that each family is having their own responsible toilet. So the conditioning will be key part of it. Another thought is, although I think in Hong Kong it's quite common to have bedrooms all facing the windows, the biggest window in the house, but actually bed is a place that actually we sleep. It should be the darkest place of the house. So we try to put the bed in the middle of the house, so that actually the most part private space is in the middle, in the center of the house. The other space, they can use it for bed if they need a second bedroom, or they can use it as a study space if they see it in the lighting. So these are the partition that we imagine. If it's maximum public, they can even share the living room, have a living room together, and the middle space is for sleeping. They can always lock the doors so that basically they make this panel fix, choose the medium, medium private space. So the family, you know, actually have more private space and a light blue area is a shared space. So this is maximum privacy when two family actually doesn't get along to each other, so they just use the door to get in and have a maximum space in the house as a private space. So these are the two families that move in. So when we first visited them, I think it's quite interesting. One of the families say, it's okay, I would like to open my partition all the time. The other family say, they will say that they would like to open their partition as well. But behind the other family, they will start to tell us that actually I prefer to close the partition. So it's quite an interesting psychology behind how people would live together. Because people have their own privacy and they don't necessarily really share that easily with other people. So I hope actually after they have lived together for maybe 2 years, they have more opportunity to own the condition and be able to share the space. That's all that we can share. If there are time, or if anyone interested about trying to Google project, we also have some information.
I think it's obviously very relevant for what they are doing and what we'll do in the next phase of the studio. I know this is a very good link to the reality of the project of this kind. So it's a very rare chance that we have these two practitioners. They raise issues in the architectural rendering and architecture. So any one of you would have some questions? This is okay.
Thank you. Thank you for a very, very good talk and very relevant to, as Keith said, to what we're going to do. Extremely useful and interesting. My just a quick question for the subdivided flats. Do you have a budget for the furniture?
Yes.
Are you supposed to disclose it?
Yes.
Is it a fixed one for every single family, etc.?
Maybe we can talk a little about that.
Please, yes.
You can talk a little bit about how the project is funded. So actually, for this project, we received as a private donor who donated money for the production of the furniture and some of the implementation of the case. And then we have a match funding as well. So this is how the operation is supported through one funding model. And the actual furniture is donated to the family. So we had some discussion whether the family should pay for the furniture, but our conclusion was that basically donation model is better. If they started paying for the furniture, then their requirements would suddenly change and then it become a lot more complex. So we stuck to the donation model. In terms of the price, roughly our budget is around 10,000 to 12,000 for the family. But it's not really fixed. There's flexibility with it, so we can spend more if the family has more needs, or we can spend less if they don't need so much. Also, it depends on the size of the family. Some families are just single mother with one child. Other families may be five people, two parents and three children. So it's kind of some flexibility. But 10,000 to 12,000
You're still working on this project. After like 5 years.
Yes.
5 years.
90 families.
I think more than 90 families. I'm kind of interested to know how many types of furniture, because you're working on modular things. So probably you would become a kind of prototypical units. So how many types roughly? 10 types or just 3 types?
You mean how many different modules?
Yes, how many different modules and pieces?
So the basic module is this, so it's around 750 millimeters wide by, depends on the height, maybe 700 for the desk, and then the depth is about 450. So this is a quite a standard unit, and it's partly based on the size of a piece of plywood, so we're trying to maximize the efficiency. At the same time, it also kind of, we don't want to make it too big so they can't fit in the house, but also small that it's not usable, so we kind of settled on this figure. So this is a standard unit, so you can see we have like cupboards, shelves, like a computer table, drawer, and then there's like a folding desk. This one's a folding, fold-down unit. And then so the standard unit is this 750 width, but we also have a half unit, so we can, it's exactly half the size. Basically, because we, like Maggie said, we had this idea of using the modular system for kind of for efficiency of cost. But also it's, as a family, like we can add more units in the future if the family wants to, if there's circumstance change. So it's easier to add like a standard size to another standard size. But also, obviously, the limitation in the standard fixed size module is that, say, your room you can fit in a 750 unit, but then the next space is only like 600, and you can't fit in a second unit. So this is why we had the idea of using a half module as well, so it gives us a degree more flexibility. But even then, there's still limitations within the sizes, so we did later introduce this one on the, basically this is just using a kind of post system with boards, and this one we can adapt to any length. So this kind of gives us the maximum flexibility.
So this basically kind of reverse this idea to identify a separate plan and sort of become a great advantage of variations.
Yeah. So we didn't actually count how many variations are. Probably 30.
I like the fact that the furniture architecture presents themselves also or something that we generally call alternatives. Yeah, but there are certain aesthetics and certain quality of practicality that reflect that how visualization actually turns out to guide the design, which is actually, I think, a very important thing for students like you to learn. We're not just acting on beautiful things, to design is not about designing, just designing things that please our lives. More important when it comes to the very fundamental idea of how pictures serve is actually intimate. Okay.
I would say that we also are interested in aesthetics as well. We're not like totally.
Of course. I appreciate that very much.
Because we chose the material we use is a plywood, but it's like a very standard plywood you buy, which is one side is the whiteboard and the other side is the raw material. And we kind of designed it in a way so that the raw material as far as possible is on the outside and then the white material is on the side. So it's kind of, on the outside it's a little bit softer maybe, but on the inside it's easier to wipe down. It's easier to clean.
Personally, I found that the furniture has a very beautiful things. So I think that you need to start by targeting it as a very object to be designed.
Yeah.
In the end, because you understand the practicality of the things, how things are used, and how proportions and dimensions can actually help to create that utility. In the end, you also actually become a sense of aesthetics. It's not something to become very beautiful things of office or more. So I think that is something you should appreciate. Start from very basic things in the process of the development of these basic things, the aesthetics that you come in, it turns out to be something that is cool. I was very interested in the last project. I think it's going to be a very exciting experiment, which is just starting to happen. So I'd like you to come back again, maybe a few times later, so that you can actually sort of
show us what is the impact of how that kind of project is to. So it's just a, okay.
I have maybe a comment or question. That's not so much to do with the furniture, but maybe slightly theoretical, which is that in a way what you presented here is a, I guess, a kind of a classical dilemma of the architect. Right? On the one hand, you're trained to maybe embrace the market. Right? On the other hand, there's this kind of urgent condition in the city that you cannot embrace the market. You almost have to resist it in order to contribute. So in your kind of earlier slides where I saw this cover of the Tafuri Utopia, Architecture and Utopia, how did the formative of education did it inform you, prepare for this round, how did you kind of choose to operate at this kind of middle ground? Because if you don't resist, you become a service provider for that pyramid that you describe. And on the other hand, if you completely resist, you also cannot contribute. You stay within the theoretical. Maybe you write and you make projects, you make paper projects. So I guess my question is, after working on this project, of working with the underprivileged, what do you see as the kind of the end? What would be the tipping point? Let's say in Chicago in the 1890s, there was a big fire that started a kind of a building regulation. Or Shaki May, a big fire, so that public housing is needed. What do you see as the kind of end game for this project? Is it lack of space problem, or is it more complex than that?
Difficult question.
To that question, but it's kind of how I guess I then went back to And Jerry, he was my professor, he recommended that I read this book because I was kind of going now. I was interested in this field. And it really, it kind of opened up my head. But then at some point, you kind of have to stop, put the book to the side, say it's an interesting question, but now you need to kind of take a step forward and progress with your architectural career. And I think that's where, like, if you look at other people, other architectural practitioners and what they're doing, so and looking I guess try to be less pessimistic in your viewpoint and kind of look at the more optimistic models of architecture, which is why at that time you were really influenced by the Moog Studio. So it's kind of looking at taking this group of disadvantaged people who maybe the economic system has led to them being in this disadvantaged situation, but then how as architects, we still have, say you look at the situation of these disadvantaged groups, and then as an architect you just say, okay, it's none of my business, I'm just going to work for a developer, or I just work for a client of mine. Or do you kind of say, okay, these are human beings, I'm a human being, these people are not living in a good condition, so can I use my kind of professional expertise to maybe make their life a little bit better? So this kind of explains the path that we took and how the office set up. Going a really long-winded way of answering your question. In terms of which way is the project going, it's still, I think, so for the furniture project then, this is what we're dealing with. In a sense, the project we're working on is really a sticking plaster kind of solution to this. Are these people living here are not in an ideal situation. We've taken the view that we're not going to ignore it, we're going to do something to try and help them, but actually providing furniture, it's not giving them a bigger space, it doesn't make the house miraculously better to live in, it's just a little, maybe, it's 1% better than it was before, it's like a tiny little change to make their life a little bit better. I mean, there's some part of the project is looking at a long-term benefit, whether, like this idea that if the children can study better at home, then if they do better, if their academic results are better, then that would kind of in the long term help the family to escape this kind of situation. But still, you have to look at what is the fundamental causes which are causing this kind of place to, this condition to exist. And that's something through our project, that's something we're not tackling. I think as a professional, as a designer, you can't change the world through furniture. You can't change your world by making it a better space. I think you can make people's lives better, but if you're really interested in making fundamental change, probably you need to look more at policy, go into government or something. I think you really need there's kind of limitations to what we can do through design, which is what I'm trying to say. That's not to say we shouldn't do anything. So it's kind of like balancing these two things. Does that start to answer your question?
Yes. I think you have both right answers this question. On the other hand, you can express more than what the potential impression has been for. So yeah, I'm particularly admiring your practice. As I had some chat with Mackie earlier before, because it actually struggled a lot in terms, trying to keep his practice on and try to do as much as they can. If I have a chance to answer Peter's question, then it's not about a theoretical argument, so it's more about taking the problem we actors would. And if you can do it a little bit, at a certain point you will tip it off. I think that effect will just come out enormously. And that's something I think what Don Mack is actually struggling with and trying hard to do that. And I hope you will, at a certain point of time, he will actually try the things and present to us even more hopeful optimism. optimistic kind of impact to our society. That's what I'm looking for. So today's the Autumn Festival. We are very precious of these two guys because they are quite different species from all the lectures we have gone through. So if you do have any questions, the better the time will be, we could say thank you to them as a kind of appreciation for their time. Okay, so I have it back to you too.
We will be dismissed.
Yes, right. And four groups.
And you present what you have done to your groups. So we have about 10 minutes.
10 minutes. Thank you very much.